heavyweight champions have made their way to the battle. Toto Miata, you are notoriously private and selective with your interviews. The Chakra Monster is proving to be quite difficult out there.
There's no question. 1,000 years of rain have proven to be quite tricky.
1,000 years of rain!
As you know, your offense is quite stifling. How did you become such a proficient attacker?
I wish I could say it comes naturally to me, but it comes from hours and hours of watching tape, studying other heroes' attacks on Crunchyroll.
Crunchyroll?
A monthly subscription anime website that's created by true anime fans.
And that's your secret.
My body's a temple. And if you are what you watch, then I'll only consume the best 25,000 hours of pre, ad-free, up-to-date content. Full device access. That there is.
Start your free trial today.
No.
Oh, jumping, not running.
Yes, jumping, yes, running. Don't make it in time.
Is that bad? You want to run?
Yeah.
I can run you over.
Okay, then. Run me over, then.
The chakra monster has been rampaging downtown Culver City for nearly 5 hours now. All of the great. The chakra monster has been rampaging downtown Culver City for nearly 5 hours now. All of the great anime champions have made their way to the battle.
Thank you. No.
Thank you. fact, wait, quote, raw story here. An evangelical Christian organization has called on right-leaning pastors to, quote, investigate the family and staff of U.S. presidential candidates in order to expose anyone who's secretly gay or who supports LGBT rights. Okay. I'm amused by the idea of Christian conservatives going up to Republicans being like, I need to expose and investigate your staff because I think you might be gay. Okay, the guy leading this movement is David Lane. He's from America Renewal Project. I got one video for you guys about him in a second. But first, let's tell you about this danger that they are warning about. They say, as the race begins in the 2016 Republican presidential primary, evangelicals have no choice but to investigate which consultants and operatives are behind each of the candidates' decisions about personnel, provide evidences about policy. Decisions about personnel provide evidences about policy. So they said, look, man, we got to get serious about this thing. Because if it turns out their staffers are gay, or they have inclination.
Chakra Monster has been rampaging downtown Culver City for nearly 5 hours now.
A former White House political director, referring to Melman, who also served as presidential campaign manager and a Republican Party chairman, announced after he left Washington that he's a homosexual and an advocate for homosexual marriage. Now, he does make one decent point. He says, why didn't he say that when he depicted himself as a family values conservative to win in an election? Well, that point is at least somewhat fair because they do lie about it. Ken Melman lied before he outed himself after it was no longer relevant. Now, to me, he should have outed himself earlier just to say, oh, by the way, even though I'm in the middle of running an anti-gay campaign in 2004, I'm gay. That would have been relevant, not just to Christian conservatives, but to all voters, right? Now, that's our only point of agreement. These guys, of course, believe exact opposite of us, that it's horrible if you find out someone is gay, and that means that you shouldn't have anything to do with them. Now, just to add some extra fun to the story, we've got videos of these kooks. So let's have a little bit of fun. Let's begin introducing you to these cast of characters.
The main organizer is David Lane.
35 years ago, one of the wildest men that ever lived. I deserved judgment, and I got mercy.
And God's mercy led Lane to this. A movement that mixes faith and politics with the goal of returning this nation back to its original founding principles.
And justice for all.
If the Lord does it, we're going to turn America back to Him. And reestablish a Christian culture. Some of these values are going to reign supreme. So my guess is, spiritually speaking, we need mercy. The mercy of God.
I love the beginning of that, because he's like, oh, 35 years ago, I do everything terrible. Right? So after you did all that and had all your fun, all of a sudden then you find Jesus, which is fairly convenient, and then try to prevent the rest of us from having fun. That's terrific. Thanks a lot, Mr. Pastors and Pews. What a disastrous name, if you ask me. Hi, I'm part of Pastors and Pews. Okay, more from these kooks.
I just think we have to make people aware, you know, and bring the Bible back into the school and start teaching our kids at a younger age and, you know, focus on the younger generation. They're being taught the other ideas, the gay agenda every day out in the world. So we have to stand up and explain to them that that's not real, that's not proper, it's not right.
No, they've been taught the gay agenda. Okay, listen, all we say is if you're gay, you should have the same rights as every other American. Nobody's going around saying like, hey Bobby, psst, come over here. Check out what these gays are doing. Who's saying that, man? Nobody's encouraging anybody to be gay.
Of homosexual marriage.
I'm telling y'all, this is breaking my heart. This is serious stuff. And our Lord is fixing to look at the Father, and he's finna say America will not do. They're just not gonna get it.
What was that? That's the straight guy, right? That's what I'm giving to believe.
The Lord fixing to look at the Father.
What are you crying over, man? Grow up. Everything's gonna be. And then I saw gay news, and then the Lord freaked me out. Dude, straighten up, man. Straighten up, okay? That's okay. Whether you're gay or straight, be a man, okay? Don't cry in front of everybody. And they're like, no, no, the Lord gonna do this. The Lord gonna do. Okay, then he's gonna do it. Just calm down and move on with your life.
And guys, get out of our lives, man. Go lead for your own life. Is that wouldn't that be amazing if God gave you life, you went out there and actually lived it instead of worrying about what Steve's up to, Bob is up to. Now I got fun that you're having over there. God, what you do? Why you didn't have, let me have that fun, my dear?
God, their lives suck. That should be a great consolation to us, man. They're over there just worrying about the sky god and what he's up to and how he's judging them. Oh my God, their lives are miserable. It feels so good to be liberated. Okay, we're not asking you to be any particular orientation. We're asking you to be free. I believe that puts us on the side of America. Young Turks. Exciting news, everybody. We're up for two Webbies. Kind of. We're not up for two Webbies. Young Turks up for one Webby, and that is for news and politics. We want to win the People's Voice Award, and you guys get to vote on that, and that's what has led to every Emmy Webby we've ever won is when you guys vote for us. So we'd really appreciate that. Interesting little side note. Anna Kasparina kind of up for a Webby having nothing to do with the Young Turks.
Oh,
okay. So
one of the most surprising moments of my life. I did not see that coming.
So she's in the reality category because she did Sundance TV's Dream School. I also did that. Apparently, I was not good enough to qualify for a Webby, but Anna was. She's in a category with Bravo and CNN and something called 72 and Sunny, which I thought was had something to do with Philadelphia, but apparently doesn't. Okay. We're up against Reuters TV, AJ Plus, and HuffPost Live. So we want you guys to vote if you can. The links are in the video below, of course, just to make it super simple.
I love when you go on a Huffington Post and you click on an interesting story and it's a video. It's a live conversation about it. It's great. It's great. It's my favorite thing.
I haven't said a word. I didn't say anything.
Have you finished your gay agenda homework yet? Nice tweets. I'm amused by them. I'm pretty sure that's not how it goes, but I think that the conservative minds, the atheists, you're right. That's how they think, we want the world to go. Okay. Now, I don't know if you noticed if you're watching the show live during the breaks. Yes, we're still having voting on the Webbies. That is up very, very soon, so I need you to go and vote now if you can. So that is, the link can be found super simple on tytnetwork.com, okay? So just go to tytnetwork.com, you'll find the link to the Webbies. By the way, while you're there, if you're in Washington, D.C. this Friday, April 24th, Ben and I are doing a live show at the museum. It's going to be badass. Also get tickets for that, okay? If you're not a student, you do need to buy tickets, but you get a pass for the museum for the whole day, which you should go to anyway. If you're a student, you have a valid student ID, and you mention TYT, it'll be free. So check that out at tytnetwork.com as well. And finally, another important note for what's happening later in the week. On Thursday, April 23rd, there's a committee hearing for the Wolfpack resolution to get money out of politics in Texas, of all places. Yes, We have it introduced in Texas by a very conservative Republican because they too hate corruption in politics. So if you'd like to participate in there, by the way, a lot of conservatives and libertarians now also participating in Wolfpack. We'd love to have you show up in Texas. You don't have to testify or anything like that. We just want to fill the place and show our presence there. If you'd like more information on that, wolf-pack.com/Texas, okay? So it's this Thursday. Go show up. Be heard. We'd love to have you there. wolf-pack.com/Texas. Go get them in Texas, okay? Now, let's move on to the rest of the stories of the day. Great news. We actually have a cop in America who not only did the right thing, but it's a bit of a hero, really. His name is Officer Jesse Kidder. He had found out that there was a guy on the streets who was trying to basically do suicide by cop. The dispatcher told him this, and so he told him to be wary. Now, the guy is super aggressive in coming towards him. At some point, you're going to see the video, Officer Kidder actually gets knocked down. And he still doesn't shoot the guy. It's amazing, okay? And he was wearing a body camera, so we got to see all of it. So let's watch the video, and then I'll give you more details afterwards.
Suspected of traveling there to kill someone. So, possibly highly dangerous. He's got his hands in his pockets. And Officer Kidder backs up throughout this video as you watch it here, right? This guy, I think, is an absolute American hero. I think a lot of cops would say, hey, wait a minute now, he took too many risks. I wouldn't have taken those risks. Here the guy says, shoot me, and he's threatening to do violence, and he's got his hands in his pocket, and he's approaching the officer. I think a lot of cops would already shot that guy. And you know what? That guy would be dead right now. He didn't need to die. He isn't dead. And Officer Kidder acted with great courage. Not just restraint, but courage. And to say, hey, you know what? My pride isn't as important as doing the right thing here. A lot of people, they don't back up because of their pride. Not because, oh, it would make the situation more dangerous necessarily. Now, he's a 27-year-old Marine veteran, the officer here, and he'd been just a police officer for a year. Obviously, had gone through plenty of danger in his life, and I love that he did the right thing here. And then finally, he said, law enforcement officers all across the nation have to deal with split-second decisions that mean life or death. I wanted to be absolutely sure before I used deadly force. Fantastic, man. If every cop in America reacted the way that Officer Kidder did, then I think we'd be in a lot better situation. I think communities across the country would respect and trust the police officers a lot more. And somebody's alive today because of his restraint and his courage. And I think that's a wonderful thing. Now, Michael Wilcox doesn't seem like the best character in the world, but who knows? Maybe he's got mental health issues. Obviously, if he's trying to get killed by a cop, he's got significant mental health issues. There's a lot of things that need to be done with him, but killing him wasn't one of them. So thank God Kidder showed the courage that he did. Great work. Okay. God, that felt good to do a good story about cops. Okay. Terrific. Now, let's go to, unfortunately, not such a great story about cops. Right? Here we go. Now, luckily, nobody got killed here. Nobody got tased. All right. So,
good news in Parma, Missouri. They've got change. Now, look, not everybody's in favor of the change. The person who won the mayoral race there is... a new mayor. She hasn't been mayor before. She was a city clerk in the past. And she's done missionary work, etc. Her name is Tyrus Bird. Okay. Now, she only won by 37 votes, but she's participating in the process. She won, so that's wonderful. People participated in the democratic process. Great news, right? Overall. No. Not for some in Parma, Missouri. It's a fairly small town, but apparently a lot of the people who worked there were upset and decided to quit. Who led the charge? The cops. 5 out of the 6 police officers in the town resigned. Immediately, because of who became mayor. By the way, if you're unclear about what they're concerned about, I'll tell you their official concern in a second. She happens to be the first female and African-American mayor of that town. I'm sure a wild coincidence that that's why they happened to quit when she became elected mayor. No, but they say it is because of her. Don't get me wrong. I'll tell you their official reason in a second. But they're not alone, not just the cops. The city attorney also quit. So did the clerk. And the wastewater treatment plant supervisor. The guy who deals with the sewage is like, no, she's not good enough for me. Ah, you know what? I'm so glad that they quit. Get the fuck out of here, man. You don't want to do your job. Because the people of your town elected a new mayor? Well, that's your problem, man. Go somewhere else where you find like-minded people and go deal with their sewage. So what's their concern? Why they quit? They said, quote, because of safety concerns. What the fuck does that mean, safety concerns? Safety over what? She does missionary work. What do you mean safety concerns? Come on, man. This is beyond the pale. And they have a black mayor for the first time who's worked in the government before. She's born and raised in that town. And she's an exemplary person. No, I got safety concerns. The dude working the sewage plant's got safety concerns. The city attorney's got safety concerns. What safety concerns are you alluding to? If I was her, though, I'd be thrilled with this. Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. I'd had to deal with your stupid racist ass the whole time when I was mayor. Thank you for weeding yourselves out immediately. Good. You're fired. You're free to go. Get the hell out of here. No, better yet, you quit. I don't even have to pay you unemployment or anything. Depends on the laws of Missouri. Still, get the fuck out. Okay. Jesus Christ, man. Oh, we have a black president. Everything's all right. Racism is cured. And for those of you who say, well, you don't know it's because it's racism. Really, what do you think it's about? She was going to ambush them with missionary work? That's what they were concerned about? Now, oh my God, we have somebody actually representing the community. Heaven forbid!
Let me speculate on the safety concerns. We've mentioned this before. These particular people who probably have an issue, and of course we're speculating wildly, with her race and probably the fact she's a woman as well, they put themselves in a position of how they feel about her, and they're thinking, well, she must feel that way about me. So if I was in charge, I would continue to not represent certain people, certain aspects of our society, so then she's going to do that to me now. She's turning the tables because I'm a heartless asshole who's racist or who's bigoted and who doesn't care about anyone else but people like me. She's going to do this to us now. Oh my God, I'm in trouble. Because they think that's how everyone thinks, because that's how their mind works.
Now, that's a great point by JR. As always, classic projection. I know that when I was in charge, I never looked out for people like her. I only looked out for my own. Since she's in charge now, I assume that she's as bad a person as I am, so she'll only look out for her own. Well, I'm not her own, so I got to go. Okay, good riddance, good riddance. She said her first order of business will be to clean up the city. Well, they've already helped her tremendously in doing that, and they're well on the way to cleaning up Parma, Missouri. And if they hate the town that much, by the way, they should also relocate. Get the hell out. Go, 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 go. Get out. Clean up. Go home. Okay. I think my feelings on that story were fairly clear. Now, let's move on to the Pope. The Pope, I didn't see this graphic before. Is he turning into the Incredible Hulk? Okay. Or, the Jolly Green Giant, yes. Okay, perhaps in some ways. Okay. Let me tell you all about the story. Okay. The Vatican just announced that they're going to have a major conference on climate change this month. Wow, that's interesting. They're going to have some great speakers. UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon cares greatly about climate change. He'll be there. Jeffrey Sachs from Columbia University will be there. That's relevant because he runs the Earth Institute at Columbia University. He's also a rational human being, also believes that climate change is happening and that it's man-made. And the Pope has what they're describing as a green agenda. So, of course, conservatives are up in arms over this. They're quite upset. And they should have been a little bit clued into this already. He's Francis of Assisi, or he's named after the Francis of Assisi, and he was the unofficial patron saint of ecology. So, and he's always had this agenda as in reality and protecting the earth. The Pope has an agenda, right, to protect God's creation, and that's what he thinks he's doing here. So obviously, the conservatives in America are super pissed about that. Let me give you more details here. They say that he aims to elevate the debate on the moral dimensions of protecting the environment in advance of the papal encyclical. So if you're like me and not a Catholic scholar, you might not know what that is. So let me explain. An encyclical is one of the most authoritative documents a pope can issue. So he's about to say something that is very important for Catholic doctrine, and he's going to talk about how we've got to take care of the earth. Now, if you're a conservative American, you've been pretending to be religious your whole life, especially those Catholics out there, and telling us all the time on conservative issues, the Pope, the Pope, the Pope! Now, you've conveniently left out that all the popes have been against the wars when you were totally in favor of the wars, and the popes are against the death penalty when you're in favor of the death penalty, but you pretended to be on good, solid religious grounds anyway. Now, you're on almost no sound religious grounds when this pope disagrees with so many of the things that you do, including burning the earth to the ground in order to get more fossil fuels out of it. Now what are you going to do? You're going to say, oh, the Pope, we never meant to listen to the Pope. No. That whole, you know, the infallible stuff, and he's the ultimate authority on what the Bible says. The Holy Ghost says he shall not have any error. We didn't mean that. Instead, Maureen, the appropriately named Maureen Malarkey, writes in First Things, which is a conservative publication, that the Pope is, quote, an ideologue and a meddlesome egoist. Dude, he's the Pope. I think he gets to be an egoist. I mean, if you've got a direct pipeline to God, I think it's fairly fair to have a large ego. But, hey, I didn't say that. In terms of Catholic doctrine, I find it preposterous. No, I don't think he talks to God. No, I don't think he's infallible. No, I don't think he should dictate the religious dogma that you should all live by. But you've been telling me my whole life that that's what the Pope is if you're Catholic. Now all of a sudden he's got a big ego? Well, you're the one who gave it to him. You made him Pope. He's meddlesome. That was my problem with the Pope all along. Don't tell me how to live my life. But you guys insisted, you conservative Christians insisted that he was supposed to meddle. He was supposed to tell us how to live our life. Don't use birth control. Don't have an abortion. Don't do all these things. Now all of a sudden he doesn't agree with you and he's meddlesome. And he's an ideologue. What a funny joke. She continues that his premature, intemperate policy endorsements on the environment are not a good idea. Okay? Intemperate. Funny word to use in this context. Okay. He has actually studied it. In fact, he's going to study it even more. They've got a whole conference on it. And they're going to make their findings encyclical. Right? But what you guys want is, God, let us burn more fuel. Let us extract it from the ground as much as we possibly can. We heat up the atmosphere, so what, right? And, of course, she's not alone. George Weigel, another conservative author, Robert George, a so-called political philosopher in Princeton, another conservative, are all upset with the Pope. How dare the Pope try to pretend that he represents all Catholics? That's kind of his job, dude. Okay, so finally, if you're unclear about where the Pope stands, let me quote the Pope. Pope Francis says, "It is a man who has slapped nature in the face. We have, in a sense, taken over nature. He says, a Christian who does not protect creation is a Christian who does not care about the work of God. Well, that seems fairly clear. So, all of you conservative Catholics in America, you've got two choices. Either stop talking about, how Catholic doctrine is always right, and we need to listen to your views on birth control, abortion, and all those other issues. Okay? Because you're saying now, no, never mind. Never mind. The Pope is wrong. He's meddlesome, and he's intemperate, and we never meant for you to listen to the Pope. Or say, no, you're right. We said the Pope was right all along. The Pope can't be wrong. The Pope says it. It must be true. My bad. You're right. Climate change is happening. It is a real danger. It is man-made. And we need to make sure that we protect God's creation. I'm with you. Which one is it going to be? You can't be logically consistent and say, no, I'm not going to do either one of those things. On the other hand, they're conservatives, so of course they don't care about logic at all. So, screw the Pope. God never meant to talk to the Pope. He meant to talk to me. The guy getting money from the oil companies. Yeah, that's what he meant. Yeah, that's the ticket. Okay. I'm moving forward. Oh, this is a fun story. Everybody get ready to have fun, okay? It's funny graphic on it as well. Okay, all right. Now, let me tell you what is going on here. Okay. Recently, we had a flare-up in Georgia because some protesters were trampling on the flag. They were, right? They were very upset about what's going on and what the United States is doing, so they decided to walk all over the flag. I don't like this kind of protest. Never liked it, but it's a free country. They can do anything they like, and so there they are walking on the flag. Well, someone else didn't like protest, and so on that whole freedom thing. Her name is Michelle Manhart. She's actually a veteran of the U.S. Air Force, and she got livid over this. Now, her past with the American flag is awesome. Wait till you see that. But before we get to that, let me show you how upset she got about this protest. She grabbed their flag, and this is what happened next.
That's not here. Actually, it is. Anything on or ripped, it needs to be properly disposed of.
We're going
to
take care of that.
Okay. This belongs to actually the entire United States. It's not yours.
Now, she's clearly in the wrong. That's why the officers decide that she's got to give the flag back. It's their flag. She goes, no, it belongs to the entirety of the United States. But first of all, that makes no sense. That's not how property works. That would actually be a communist position, just to be clear. And second of all, you don't represent the entire United States. No, it's their property. You have to, I understand why you're mad, right? But okay, you made your point. Now you got to give their property back. And that's what the cops think. And she's simply not going to do it. So then this bit of fun madness ensues.
Yeah,
you're famous. They got it on camera. Don't worry.
like the guy in the background has. She ain't gonna get shot, is she? I mean, what an interesting exhibition of privilege that, right? She's like, you're putting your hands on me. Yeah, that's what happens when you get arrested, right? They gotta put your hands, they put their hands on you, right? She's like, she says, why are you not touching her? Because she didn't steal your shit. You stole her shit. That's why they're touching you and arresting you. Now, they detained her, and they eventually let her go. Again, another form of privilege. She didn't get tased, and thank God she didn't. I'm glad the cops handled the best they could, right? But she's got to return the property at a bare minimum, right? I mean, in a lot of other cases, the cops wouldn't have been like, oh, okay, now you gave the property back, so we'll let you go, right? So that's what she got with. Okay, so that's the situation at hand there. But wait, it's about to get more fun. Now, technically, on the flag and the desecration, she's actually right. That's the U.S. flag code. You don't get arrested for that, okay? It's a free country. You can do whatever you want with the flag. Just the U.S. flag code says you shouldn't do that. Now, since Michelle Manhart is so emotional about this and so invested in it, I'm sure she's never violated that provision in the U.S. flag code. Now, go ahead and show me a picture where that is clearly not the case. Oopsie-doopsie. That flag appears to be on the ground, as well as on the merchandise. Now, let's go back to the U.S. flag code. The flag should never be used as wearing apparel, bedding, or drapery. It should never be festooned, drawn back, nor up in the folds, but always allowed to fall free. Okay, let's go to more pictures. This again is Michelle Manhart. Well, that is falling free, that is true, but it does appear to be apparel since it is covering her ass. Okay, but that's not the only time. Whoa, wait a minute! Once again, touching merchandise appears to be apparel or some sort of drapery for her bosom. Why she left the Air Force? Does she pose nude for Playboy in her uniform? She took off her uniform and was like, hey, here's my boobies. I have the video, by the way, of similar situation in a second. And the Air Force is like, you can't do that. You can't use your uniform when you're posing for Playboy. She's like, I will not accept the demotion. That's it. I'm stepping down. So I'm not interested in protecting the American people anymore because you will.
understand this. So when Conrad Hilton made his fortune by, among other things, creating this hotel chain, he got taxed, right? Every time you make income, you have income, you report it, you get taxed. That's normal. Everybody goes through the same thing, right? This is not double taxation on Conrad Hilton. When he passed away and he passes money on to his heirs, including Paris Hilton, he's already dead. Who's being taxed is not Conrad Hilton. It's Paris Hilton. Paris Hilton has never been taxed on that money. She, in essence, won a lottery here. By the way, if you win the lottery, you get taxed, right? Anytime you've got new income coming in, you get taxed. So Paris Hilton does not get taxed on the first $10.8 million. Afterwards, she'd be taxed 40%, which is what, if you're in that bracket, that's the price you normally pay anyway. The top bracket is about 40%. Republicans say, no, we must save Paris Hilton. She must never be taxed on any of that money. By the way, there's also an extra kicker in this law that says even Conrad Hilton, and there's a generation between Conrad and Paris, all of them would get to save on capital gains. They actually would never pay any tax on it. Not double taxation, zero taxation, as long as they pass it on to their heirs. That is such an injustice for all of you out there who earn some income, get a paycheck, and pay taxes on it. The only people who wouldn't have to pay taxes are the enormously wealthy. That is ridiculous. So, now let me tell you what happened. House Republicans recently voted to hand heirs and heiresses of America the largest fortunes at $269 billion tax break by repealing the federal inheritance tax. Now, it hasn't passed the whole Congress, and the president will likely veto it, but the House Republicans say, this is what we're in favor of. Wait a minute, I thought you guys cared about the budget. What about the budget? Oh my God, deficit! Oh, the budget's out of control! That's more than a quarter of a $1 trillion hole you're putting in our budget to help a couple of dozen families in the country. They're going to take out $269 billion out of our government to fund all the things that we need. By the way, no things we don't need. We all stay. They say, no, we're going to spend more money on more wars, but you're going to pay for it, not Paris Hilton, and not those people who are going to get it tax-free. Unbelievable. Okay, again, let's give you more context here. Only individual fortunes worth over $5 million than the median American household from taxation. The Republican. In favor of protecting people who are 15,700% richer than the average American. Why do you say we're in favor of the rich? I don't know where you got that idea. Huffington Post explains a little further. And the legislation wouldn't just eliminate the estate tax. It would also allow heirs to escape the already generous capital gains tax on any stocks and real estate that they receive. The change would significantly alter the meaning of the capital gains tax, since capital gains taxes only hit the wealthy when they actually sell an asset. So in this case, they wouldn't be selling the asset at all. They'd just be passing it on to their heirs, and hence would never be taxed the first time around. And final part of it is moguls could keep their wealth in the stock market and pass it down from generation to generation without ever being taxed. Remember, the whole point, the Republicans said, of getting rid of the estate tax in the first place was that it was so unjust because it was double taxation on the rich. Now they're saying, no, we'd like zero taxation on the rich. In that way, they create a new royalty for us, a new elite, our lords, our princes and princesses that shall reign over us. They never get to share in any of the booty, okay? Paris does share in the booty a little bit, to be fair. Okay, what about the others? Never get taxed and pass it on from one generation to another. Now, my idea is, no. They should actually get taxed much earlier than $10.8 million, and the tax should be a little bit more significant. I think it's fair to say, hey, listen, if you've made whatever the number is, you're going to pass on $2 million to your kids, $5 million to your kids as a couple, whatever you think is fair. Right now, like I said, it's just at $10.8 million. Anything beyond that, you give 50% so that the next generation has an opportunity, right? So Sam Walton had an opportunity. Some might disagree with what he did, but a lot of people think he worked hard and deserved everything he got. Okay, fine, great. Well, why don't we take 50% of that estate and normal tax? Again, not on Sam Walton. He just got taxed once. But on his
heirs and say, hey, let's provide that same opportunity Sam Walton got for a whole new generation of Americans. Let's take it and give it in free education to people. I know conservatives, oh my God, free education! No, no, no! If you have opportunity, what do? You burn the bridge right after you cross. Well, I'm saying, no, let's build a bridge so that we could have more successful businessmen. Let's dedicate the money you get from the estate tax to free education so we've got a whole new generation of Americans who are prosperous and then who pass it down and don't hoard it like royalty. We are not their serfs. We're not here to serve them. This is supposed to be a democracy. Let's build this thing together. That is not what the Republicans believe. Here they show they don't actually care about deficits. All they care about is protecting the rich. Young Turks.
The chakra monster has been rampaging downtown Culver City for nearly 5 hours now. All of the great anime champions have made their way to the battle. Toto Miyata, you are notoriously private and selective with your interviews. The chakra monster is proving to be quite difficult out there.
No question. A thousand years of rain have proven to be quite tricky.
A thousand years of rain!
As you know, your offense is quite stifling. How did you become such a proficient attacker?
I wish I could say it comes naturally to me, but it comes from hours and hours of watching tape, studying other heroes' attacks on Crunchyroll.
Crunchyroll?
A monthly subscription anime website that's created by true anime fans.
And that's your secret?
My body's a temple. And if you are what you watch, then I'll only consume the best 25,000 hours of pre, ad-free, up-to-date content with full device access that there is.
Toto, I might get fired for asking this, but do you think just once you could show me how to use Amaterasu? Start your free trial today.
What's up? I'm Anna Kasparian, and you might wonder, what the hell is the point? Well, think of it as a news show with a twist. It's like a game of truth or dare, except... we focus solely on the truth and ask our panelists some pretty interesting questions. Have you guys ever cheated or been cheated on? Have you had a near-death experience? Have you spent money on something that you knew was wrong? What would you do in the last week of your life? Each week I'm joined by some of the smartest and most honest people around.
The worst person to run the country would be a person who wants to run the country.
Women are left out of conversations daily, especially in politics.
We love to delve deeper into the topics and have a good point to make about each story. Make your point.
Make your point.
Make your point.
The legal team at VH1 could not have done a better job at covering their own asses while getting their contestants to show theirs.
The best part about the show is that we're not afraid to share personal stories, regardless of how scandalous or controversial they might be. Give them a vibrator. Okay, they'll be very, very happy.
When I was 13, I stole a car.
Damn! I don't know, officer. What was I doing?
Bro, no.
Bananas
blew my mind. Amazing.
Look, don't marry that crazy bitch. You know,
what
keep away from her.
Guys? Honestly, we let our guard down and we tell it like it is.
Can't be that bad.
I think I'm gonna get some backlash for this, but I'm gonna be honest.
You're not supposed to cry after sex,
and that was humiliating. In fact, I feel like I'm blushing right now.
You kind of are. It's amazing. I would be livid if someone was messing with my dog. All right, you better stay the f away from Penguin.
If a hobbit decided to take a job as a longshoreman, I have his hand.
I'm also single, lady. This is progress, America. This is progress. I love it. Thanks so much for watching, and never be afraid to make your point. There is an automatic sperm extractor that is making waves at one.
I dated.
What am I doing?
But when I was walking in and I trip on one of the stupid lights and I fall on him.
However, we were not rolling thankfully, so that footage will cease to exist.
Wang wang.
It turns out when you hook up Sessions to Johnson and you show him a gay and straight porn, Mr. Johnson still says,
I'm cool now, I'm cool now.
That is not the right
clip. Oh, we got hushed in here.
Oh, hey.
What is this?
Okay, come on. I'm embarrassed to say, where's my one shot? Oh, there it is. Hey. It's what Americans want, it's what Americans buy, it's what Americans whack off to. So it works. It works.
I didn't see that coming. Literally. You remember the woman who married? I have no idea why this iPad just started playing music.
Just turn on the volume. We're good. It just turned on by itself.
I don't think it matters, and it's on social media, and I think,
John!
Drop it. You like making fun of conservatives? Yeah. I just took your line.
If you like making fun of conservatives, you should come.
Yeah! It'll be great! I'm excited about this fucking show! DYT No Apologies Tour!
July 12th, San Francisco. We'll see you there.
Yeah!
July 12th.
So it's going to be kind of entertaining. You like sexy time? You should come July 12th.
All right, welcome back to the second hour. What is this? Oh my God, look at this mega front for Pop Sugar's here.
Okay, Becca, great to have you here. Becca has worked at MTV Act, Rock the Boat. She's covered election night on 2012.
Yes, many hours.
That's right, Grammys, SAG Awards, etc. All those things she's covered. She does a show with Tyler Oakley called Top That, which is pretty badass.
That was a good time.
And so it's great to have you here. Thanks for coming.
I'm a big fan, you know, and I'm very excited to be sitting across the table from you. This is really cool. No, I'm fangirling a little bit. I'm going to admit it.
Okay, that's obviously the correct attitude. Yeah, all right. Let me read some tweets here, and then Becca's got some great stories for us. From some of the reactions to the first hour stories, Paul Charles says, give that cop a fucking medal, referring to the cop who did not shoot the guy who was asking to be a shot. It's about time we have a cop that does the right thing, so that's great. No more donations, writes in about Pope Francis and how we made him green. You wouldn't want to see Pope Frank when he gets angry. Hashtag going green, hashtag Pope Hulk.
Love the Pope Hulk.
T-Money writes in, enjoying the show. Good to hear Jinx awesome puns again. Oh, T-Money, yeah, don't worry. I think I might have more where that came from.
Oh, you better.
Okay.
I want to go puns wild in this next hour.
That's JR telling you not to encourage me. And John Connor says, conservatives say people should work hard to be rich. Except if you're the child of a millionaire, then that doesn't count. Okay. It is interesting, right? And that's the one time you don't have to work hard. If your grandpapa was a millionaire, then you can inherit all that money and not have to work at all and not get taxed on it. Okay.
That is one way to do it.
Right. And I've been saying all show because we do need, there's only a couple of days left before these two things. We need you to vote on the Webbies to try to get us the People's Voice Award for Best News and Politics Show. And Anna is up for a Webby as well for hosting on Sundance Channel. So go to tytnetwork.com and please vote for those Webbies. You guys are what make us too strong. And also, if you're anywhere near D.C. this Friday, Ben and I will be doing the Young Turks from the Newseum in Washington, D.C. So go to tytnetwork.com to get tickets there as well. And if you're in Texas, remember to go and join Wolfpack for a committee hearing where your voice will be heard. They'll get to see you in full force. Don't worry, you don't have to make a speech or anything like that, but show up with the rest of Wolfpack in Texas. Find out how to do that, wolf-pack.com/Texas. Okay. All right, Becca, what do you got?
Yes. Booyah. Okay. First story. So, John Stewart, of course, is retiring. And it's interesting, you know, is he, quote, giving up the most perfect job in the world, or is he escaping his role as a turd miner? And these are both quotes that he gave in a very intimate article and interview that he did with The Guardian, where he revealed a lot of how he's feeling about exiting the show after 16 years. And it's interesting, there's this disparity in what he's presenting and how he feels about this long-term gig that he's had. And specifically, he says, watching these channels all day, and he's talking about the media, of course, that he has to consume in gross quantities is incredibly depressing. I live in a constant state of depression. I think of us as turds. Miners. I put on my helmet, I go and mine turds, hopefully I don't get turd lung disease. Okay, so I guess he's a little frustrated, right?
Right. Yeah, you know, I both get it and don't get it. It's annoying to have to go through the whole thing all over again, like this election is coming up, so I'm with him, right? Oh, we go and pretend we don't know who Hillary Clinton is, and we do all these stories about, like, oh my God, and the fake controversies. Oh, she emailed from the wrong account, and everybody pretends to care, and, you know, and we've all seen this movie before, and it's tough not to get cynical about it, because, you know, we figured out, my guess is he's figured out, all, you know, sentient creatures have figured out that it's actually the money, right? The money controls everything in politics, and so we just go through this merry-go-round.
Right. He's worn out by the cycle. And he even says, like, the ritual of creating the show, honestly, it was a combination of the limitations of my brain and a format that is geared towards following an increasingly redundant process, which is our political process, which you just described. I was just thinking, are there other ways to skin this cat? And it sounds like he sort of felt like somebody else needed to skin the cat.
Yeah.
And he was done with it.
Yeah. Now, on the other hand, I love it, you know?
Right.
So we skin a similar cat. He just does it more from a comedy perspective, obviously. But yeah, I don't get tired of bashing Fox News. Like,
you're like, I have an endless supply of enthusiasm for that.
Yeah, I have a very healthy quantity of whoop ass that I've got ready to head in that direction. But I can see that he gets frustrated, right? And by the whole process, by Fox News, by CNN. Mm-hmm. I think he could probably feel somewhat similar. I don't want to put words in his mouth. Oftentimes, I get more frustrated by CNN because Fox News, you know where they're coming from.
Right.
You know what they're going to do. Whereas with CNN, you would hope that they would call balls and strikes and say, this is how things are. But they don't. They say, Republicans said this, Democrats said that. We're not going to tell you what the reality is.
Yeah, we're not forming any sort of like cogent opinions here.
Right.
But I think he also talks about how, I mean, I think being a liberal, as Jon Stewart obviously is, he talked about how heartbreaking it was to sort of have to hold the mirror up to the Democratic Party and point out the flaws that he didn't want to be there but were. Mm-hmm. And even interviewing Obama in his first term in a pretty, like, that was a hard-hitting interview. And a lot of people said it damaged Obama. And he was like, it was heartbreaking for him to do that. So
God, he's so much more sensitive than I am. No, like, I don't mind breaking up the Democratic Party. Like, yeah, they're taking the money. And Obama takes the money, and he doesn't bring as much change. And I don't blame him for it. I don't think they're bad people, right?
Right.
I think a lot of the Republicans are not bad people either, right? Some, but most, no.
Right.
I think that the system has created this incentive to take the money, and if you don't take the money, you're not going to win.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, yeah, that's the systemic corruption. It doesn't. That's just life. It doesn't break my heart. What makes me want to do is fix it, right?
Right.
Wolf-back.com. Okay.
Get on it.
Right.
So, I mean, the other thing is, obviously, he's moving on. Trevor Noah is taking his place. And it sounds like the timing of that switch-up is strategic, because he says in this article that he felt for the show, you don't want to leave when the cupboard's bare. So I think it's a better introduction when you have something providing you with assisted fuel, like a presidential campaign. So he did think about when he was going to exit and was like, I'll do you a solid Daily Show and leave when there's this, you know, 2016 presidential election looming that Trevor can, like, dig his teeth into.
Yeah. Now, look, he's a fundamentally decent guy. And so he could have taken advantage of the next election and gone out on a high note, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it wouldn't take that much longer time, right? He's already done it for 16 years, so he did it for, like, 17, 18 years and, you
sure.
know. But instead, he was like, no, I don't want that glory. I want to make sure the Daily Show survives because it's important. So I want to give the next host an opportunity to take advantage of that election to grow his own fan base and to keep the show healthy. He's just a great guy. He really is.
Yeah, he really is. Do you think it's the right choice, him leaving?
All right, so that's a great question. I'm not sure that I would have left if I was him because I don't know that there's any better gigs out there, right?
Right.
So, I mean, you could do movies. I guess comedians and people in the media world care about movies, and I guess movie stars are theoretically bigger. So I don't know if he looks at a Steve Carell, who used to be his correspondent and who now makes, you know, an insane amount of money per movie. And
he's
like,
making good money, though, as the host of The Daily Show, though.
Right. No, he makes great money on that, too. But I think it's more of a, like, let's keep it real. There's the great part of why he's leaving, because he's a good guy and he's frustrated by it, all that stuff. And there's the, I wonder if he looks at, like I said, Steve Carell, and like, okay, now he's a big movie star, and that's a different pecking order. Although I find that absurd. I think there is no better job than host of The Daily Show the way that Jon Stewart did it.
Sure.
So I wouldn't have left. How about you?
I mean, I'm just mourning his loss. I mean, I think everyone who feels like, I mean, it's like a death in the liberal family, I think. It just, you know,
that's
like,
a good way of putting it.
It just really is so sad, and I can't imagine him not in the media landscape. He just looms so large. Even if he self-deprecates constantly, he doesn't allow anyone to give him a compliment, and even when, you know, the interviewer in this article was like, you know, you really are a voice for the millennial generation. That's where they get their news, and he just really kind of poo-pooed it and was like, you know, I think there's so many other sources that they're tapping into, and I truly agree with the writer of this article from The Guardian that he is so plugged in with young people that connection, that relationship, I'm really sad to see that go.
Yeah, I want to where Jared thinks. Jared, I want to go to you because, look, again, I think it's super hard to keep going. I get that. Like, he says, look, I'm tired, too. Man, I've been doing it for 16 years. Got to show up to work every day. There's a daily grind, etc., right? And he wants to do new projects that are fun and different, right?
Right, so like Rosewater, like his film.
That's right. And I totally feel for him in that sense, but I feel like it's the Tonight Show from the old years, when it was the best job in town, and you don't leave the best job in town. JR, thoughts go.
I can understand it. Like when he was talking about, you know, you're feeling depressed and you're down from all the constant things you have to read and listen to. And yeah, even when you get more depressed when you see it from CNN because you'd expect something different, but you expect it from Fox, so it's fine. But the really downside is then seeing how Fox is still permeating people's brains, it's affecting people, it's changing their attitudes, and you're like, man, I remember you and I had this conversation, I'm pretty sure it was you I was talking to about this, it was right before you started up with Wolfpack, and I was like, sometimes I wonder, what the hell, what are we doing, we're just talking about it, nothing's changing, and people agree with us, yeah, cool, that's cool, but nothing is changing, we're still doing disastrous things in our country, and I don't know if we're in a place to actually do it, which would lead people to then run for office, and then they get into office, and they become the same people that we complain about, so it was a little like, you know, you almost feel defeated, even though you're doing good things. And I wonder if he just didn't want to feel that way anymore. So I understand where he's coming from. I remember I was talking to you and you said, well, we can do something. We're going to try and do something new. Watch what comes. And that was before we started the whole thing. You even kept a secret in that.
Yeah. So I think there's two huge differences between me and Jon Stewart. It's absurd to even have this conversation, but nonetheless, I'll have it.
Let's venture.
You're right. So one is he's enormously funnier than I am. As my dad once said, why you are not as funny as Jon Stewart? Right?
Stop. Everyone's dad always yelling that at us.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm your son. I blame it on your genes. Anyway. So, and the second difference is I feel like we can win. Right? I feel like I can do something about it. He always says, I'm just a comedian, right?
Right.
I'm just observing. That's all. Whereas I feel like, yeah, I'm observing, and then I like to get into the...
No, you're getting in the bear pit.
That's right. And I don't mean, like, politics and become a, like, greasy congressman, senator, whatever it is, right? No. Jared's alluding to Wolfpack, which we started to get money out of politics. And I feel, so that's why I'm energized. I don't lose energy any day, because I know we're fighting towards fixing the problem. Mm-hmm. And that feels great.
Well, we do have this one thought that Jon Stewart left us with. If Oprah can leave and the world still spins, I honestly think it will survive me. So
I'm pretty sure it'll survive. I'm sure. You know, it was important. It will survive.
It was. It was. Okay.
Yeah.
Moving on?
Yep.
Okay, story number two. The Sony hack strikes again. Allegedly, Ben Affleck's white guilt forced him to ask PBS to not reveal that he has a slave-owning ancestor. Now, this was all for an episode of a show on PBS called Finding Your Roots, and Ben's episode aired actually already in September 2014, and thanks to North Korea and WikiLeaks, who published a stash of the emails last week that North Korea, of course, hacked from Sony. Now, anyone can search those, and one of those emails revealed an exchange between PBS and Harvard scholar Henry Louis Gates and Sony Pictures co-chairman and chief executive Michael Linton, and this is what went down there. Gates wrote, here's my dilemma. Confidentially, for the first time, one of our guests, Ben Affleck, has asked us to edit out something about one of his ancestors, the fact that he owned slaves. Now, four or five of our guests this season descend from slave owners, including Ken Burns. We've never had anyone ever try to censor or edit what we found. He's a megastar. What do we do? To do this would be a violation of PBS rules, actually even for Batman. So, and then Michael Linton goes on to say, I would take it out if no one knows, but if it gets out that you were editing the material based on this kind of sensitivity, then it gets tricky.
Okay, I think this is super interesting because it goes towards what you have to negotiate in terms of access all the time. So in the news sphere, you do this with politicians. And so Chuck Todd recently admitted when he was talking to Lewis Black, a comedian, when Lewis Black said, how do you not yell at these politicians? How do you not throw it in their face? Their hypocrisy and all this stuff. And Chuck Todd said, well, if I did, they wouldn't come back on my show. And that was a really telling moment, right?
That was like a candid moment where you understand sort of the background of how these things all work.
Exactly.
The politics of interviewing politicians.
That's right. And now in the entertainment world, you get PR people. I'd be surprised if it was, and maybe I'm being too generous with Ben Affleck, but I'd be surprised if it was Ben Affleck himself. It was probably his PR people mm-hmm. who are usually mental about this stuff. They're like, hover, like, do nothing negative about my person at all, yeah. right? And so they probably were overprotective in this case, and what they're, they don't have to say it. Whether they usually implicitly threaten access. Like, if you put this out about Ben Affleck...
It's straight from Ben Affleck. We don't know that for sure. Right. So, I mean, I think everyone's sort of clickbaiting this story a lot with Ben Affleck said, you know, yeah. remove this blemish from my family tree. I don't want anyone to know about it.
Yeah, which we'll do later. So, no, but now, seriously, the flip side to this is, we're like, oh, Henry Louis Gates, a really famous Harvard professor, I can't believe he would do this. No, I can, and I don't even blame him too much. Like, of all the, like, the access issues, when you sell out, honestly, for the sake of getting Harry Reid or Mitch McConnell on your show, well, you've done a great disservice to your audience, and that stuff matters, right? And you shouldn't do this in general, but this is like, I feel like this is like a white lie, right? So Henry Louis Gates,
pun intended.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, indeed. No, that one was not intended.
Okay, I intended it.
Right. So, like, Henry Louis Gates says, look, man, there's a 10 hours of footage, but the show is much smaller. It's my editorial choice what I keep exactly. and what I don't keep. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, day to day, they got to make realistic, pragmatic choices, mm-hmm. right? Now, I don't. If he says, which he's kind of saying here, oh, there was other interesting stuff about his life, so we didn't include that. No, there was other interesting stuff.
Third great-grandfather who was a Civil War occultist. I find that compelling.
That's fascinating.
Okay, so he went with that instead of talking about a slave-owning ancestor, which it sounds like a lot of their other episodes had tapped into
right.
that.
And he apparently had an ancestor that fought in the Revolutionary War. All that stuff is interesting. Keep it real. They would have included his yeah. slave-owning ancestor. That's sure. obviously interesting enough to put in whatever edited version, right? But if PBS is like making some pragmatic decisions like this, I'm not going to hate them and get all over them for it and say, oh my God, burn down their house, right?
Right.
Like, they've done much worse things. When they made decisions based on Koch Industries funding on some of the documentaries that talked about the Koch brothers, that's real. That makes a big difference.
Yeah.
That's
like
policy
the moral
issues.
Compass on that is really spinning.
Yeah, exactly.
In a different way.
Yeah, so that's a big deal. This is not as big of a deal. Should they have done it? No. And as you can tell from the email, and he's like, if no one knows, go ahead and do it. If somebody finds out, don't do it. That's what you know you're guilty.
And then, of course, the internet knows. I mean, can you imagine, like, you know, you type something like this out, and it comes back to bite you in the ass in a major way.
Yeah, no, he's got to be mortified. Man.
Yeah, and this, I mean, honestly, at this point, I do feel bad for Sony. I mean, it just keeps... The punches keep coming with this hack. I mean, it never ends.
Really. Yeah, no, I feel terrible for them. And whoever did the hack, I'll never believe that it was North Korea. North Korea could barely get the toilet to flush. They didn't hack Sony, in my opinion.
Do you think that whole thing was...
Yeah, I don't know who did it. Whoever did it apparently is brilliant, never got caught, right?
Right.
But they really screwed over Sony in a big, big way. A lot of the people that worked there. And now, by extension, Ben Affleck. And I think that's partly why and Henry Louis Gates... Partly why I want to give them a little bit of a pass. I feel like this is all information we shouldn't have known anyway.
You're exactly right. Like that, it really is a story based on like super private information that really none of us should be privileged to be aware of.
So you know what? Now that we've just talked it through, pardon. Okay, I'm pardoning PBS and Ben Affleck. Am I not merciful?
You are so merciful. And honestly, considering all the humanitarian work that Ben Affleck does in Africa and Eastern Congo, like, it's not even hard to, like, give him a pass on all this stuff.
And
actions speak louder than an email from your PR representative.
And by the way, PR folks, just calm down, okay?
Yeah.
Just because he had a slave-owning ancestor doesn't mean anything about Ben Affleck.
No.
He didn't do it. Somebody 100 years ago did it. It has nothing to do with him. Well over 100 years ago, right? And
yeah.
So, okay, just calm down. Wherever you I'm sure, look, I found out this weekend, actually, that I had slaves. So my ancestors were slaves, okay? And, like, slaves, you know, it has a different connotation in this country. But if you got captured in war, they took you as slaves, right? For most of history, right? And I'm sure that I have even looked into it, and maybe that's why I don't want to look into it. That if you looked into my Turkish past, I guess that some of my ancestors probably had some cock ring that they did.
Right.
That was not pleasant.
Questionable situations, yeah. For sure.
I don't know anything about it. I didn't do it. It ain't me, right?
Right, okay, right.
So obviously it's not him, right? So let it go. Just calm down.
Yeah. But the spin cycle definitely got a hold of this one because of Ben Affleck, Batman, you know, Justice League, all of the above.
Yep. All right. Let's keep going. Let's do one more story this time.
Okay.
All right.
All right. So Adderall or nothing. So we know about this drug because college students usually use it to cram for their exams when you're trying to stay up all night and you need to be hyper-focused. But are workers using it in the office to actually get promoted and to see their careers skyrocket? An article in New York Times is digging deeper into the abuse of ADHD drugs outside of college and in the cubicles. And as it states, young workers are not using these drugs to get high, but hired. So the article cites a lot of qualitative evidence, actually. And so they interview 20 to 45-year-olds who are addicted to these drugs. And some of the quotes are pretty telling. And there's a woman, Elizabeth, in her late 20s. She says that not taking Adderall is the equivalent of playing tennis with a wooden racket. Like, you are not equipped to compete in a modern workplace with young people coming out of college used to popping these pills to get to the top of the class. Or, in this case, the workplace. There was a stay-at-home mom who said it's her mommy crack. How she, like, stays focused to get everything done?
I think it's time for me to jump in and say I told you so on, like, 8 of these different phenomena. First of all, I've been talking about the show about how now among students, they're all taking Adderall, right? Mm-hmm. And I think the older generation has no idea. Like, whenever you tell them, they're like, no!
They're, like, not aware.
Yeah, they have no idea the degree to which it's happening. Then I said, well, of course they're going to start taking them in the workplace because once some people are doing it, well, if you don't do it, you're going to fall behind. Mm-hmm. Or that's at least a perception. That's sure. Literally what that woman, this woman says in the New York Times article.
Yes, that's exactly what she... And the thing is, there's no hard numbers that have been crunched right now where they can say, like, oh, for sure, we can draw a connection between, you know, workers performing better that are on these ADHD-related drugs. But there are some compelling statistics. Like, American adults that receive ADHD medication, there's 2.6 million in 2012. That's a rise of 53% in only 4 years. And that's
not that many people have ADHD.
No. Okay.
They're clearly, clearly abusing it.
Yeah.
Clearly getting it when they should not be prescribed it. They're using it to have an advantage in studying and working mm-hmm. for concentration. And look, I bet that it works, but I'm also positive that it has consequences, right?
Oh, and the article discusses those as well. I mean, now there's people going into rehab who have all sorts of anxiety, who can't, you know, operate without these drugs in any sort of, like, normal capacity. And yeah. It's affecting their family and their personal relationships. Besides, you know, you might look really great to, you know, the partners when you're pulling all these all-nighters, but you are going to fall apart eventually.
Yeah, look, anytime you're overstimulating a part of your brain, and in this case, the part that makes you concentrate even on mundane tasks, so I see the value in it. It's not like I'm missing it. I'm not on Adderall, but I got it, right?
You're like, I'm aware.
Right. But anytime you overstimulate it, you're going to burn it out to some degree. And mm-hmm. so, and now a lot of these people, they don't sleep that many hours in the day, right? And then that winds up doing a lot of damage to your body. So you got to pay the piper at some point. And how long can you stay on Adderall before either you become addicted or your body starts to break down? So I don't think it's worth it in the long run. But a lot of people don't play the long run game. They think, I got this test or I got this project at work. I got to go. I'm gonna pop those pills.
Right, and they've been conditioned, and now they're, you know, coming out of college, seeing the success rate when they're using these ADHD stimulants, and then, you know, now they're gonna, like, of course they're gonna think, like, this is how I get ahead. But talking about actual industries that are trying to regulate and discuss the use of these, like, the FAA forbids pilots to use it,
mm-hmm.
you know, regardless of, like, exhaustion, and Major League Baseball considers it a performance enhancer, so. You know, even though there isn't hard evidence that you get a leg up by taking these drugs and they are working on pulling together all those kind of studies, I think it's probably safe to say that if your coworker is over there on Adderall, they're right. Probably going to get the PowerPoint done before you.
Yeah, no, it's true. Some of the downsides, they say, are rapid heartbeat, which I get from coffee, to be fair, profuse sweating, which I get from being Turkish, and acute anxiety due to sleep loss. So, look, it's not like I don't want to go, you know, reefer madness here and be like, oh my God, your head's going to explode. No, I don't think it's going to explode. But at the same time, it's the same reason why I wouldn't do ecstasy over and over again. Yeah, I get it. I did it once, and it felt amazing.
Yeah, right? Ecstasy in the workplace would be an interesting...
Well, that's, yeah, it's a little different, right? But I knew that if I kept doing that, you're going to burn out something up there. You know, the serotonin levels or dopamine levels, and then you're going to feel depressed. And I knew I had a guy, a coworker, who did do ecstasy all the time. He's the most depressed dude I ever met, right?
Yeah.
And look, I know that's anecdotal, but over the long run, and now the addiction rates are going up for Adderall, 18 to 34, especially among 18 to 34-year-olds, more people are showing up in emergency rooms. I don't want to be, you know, panicked about it and do hysteria or anything like that, but I'm just saying you should be careful because at some point you're going to burn out.
I think superiors who know that someone is operating in an inhuman way, like, you know, probably if someone you're managing is abusing these drugs,
mm-hmm.
that they should step in and be like, this is, you know, I mean, like, I feel like there's probably work cultures that perpetuate this and just turn a blind eye and are like happy to get all the TPS reports in on time, whatever, you know?
That's funny.
Full office space.
Yeah. So, no, there's like, but look, realistically, Wall Street lawyers, et cetera, they're never going to be like, you're working too hard. They're going to be like, yeah, they're going to be like, go get them, right? I'm pretty sure there's no one on Adderall at this workplace.
Wait, is that because you're just like, nobody's moving that fast?
Yeah. I've never had to step in and be like, whoa, Jesus, slow down.
Easy, Tiger.
Okay, you are working way too hard, son. I need you to bring down a notch, okay?
So can I go ahead and be the old man here? I mean, I feel like we haven't addressed this correctly.
Okay.
First of all, not buying it. I can't keep up with these 20-somethings. You know, get some sleep, eat some vegetables, take care of yourself.
Okay, tough luck.
Yeah, come on, that's bullshit. What, these 20-somethings are moving better than you? Oh, I need mommy pills. Shut up. Wake up at 6 a.m. and take care of your kid, or don't have it. I'm sorry, I sound like a conservative right now. And secondly, you mentioned Major League Baseball back, right?
Right.
So in sports, you can't have all these enhancements. Performance enhancement drugs. Why is it in any other profession, you work in an office setting, you get to be doped up and high and on some speed? I don't get it. It doesn't make any sense. That's a fireable offense. Why are they testing people for marijuana, but they're not testing people for other drugs, which are harder? It doesn't make any sense. So, I mean, kind of on both ways. They shouldn't be allowed to take this stuff. And then you shouldn't be complaining and thinking that you can't keep up if you're just not taking care of it yourself. I'm sorry, it doesn't make any sense. What if someone overeats and they're overweight and then they have heart problems or they have less mobility? Hey, take care of yourself. Now, I know there's some overweight issues that aren't just around eating too much. But if you're just low on energy just because you're too busy not being healthy, then, I mean, yeah, you still get to have your job, but let's not act like just because you're 40 and the kid next to you is 27 that you can't keep up. I don't get that. I'm sorry. And the 27-year-old kid, a 23-year-old kid, needs to get off those drugs or get the hell out of the office. You're fired.
Damn.
Step into my office because you're fucking fired. All right.
I like this new drill sergeant Jackson. Okay. I'm having issues with people. I'm going to be like, go ahead and step into JR's office.
Yeah, anyone who's working too hard or not enough, like just in general, just send JR.
That's right. Mr. Jackson would like to have a word with you.
I'm sorry, I mean, for real. Okay, no. Again, I'm thinking about the sports thing. We're worried about whether or not the quarterback is on any kind of drugs. Then we're just watching them play baseball and football and basketball. Who cares? But in workplace environments, we don't care. Why not? I don't get it.
I agree with you. It should matter. I'd be ticked if I had to be, like, you know, up for a promotion with somebody who was, like, hopped up on Adderall, just super focused. I would be really ticked off.
Okay.
But I would work really hard, JR, and not feel sorry for myself.
Okay, I think finally we get to call JR Action Jackson. Okay, like, Action Jackson's ready to take action on this, man. He will bust you up. You're on Adderall? You won't be after Action Jackson gets done with you. Okay, somebody the other day Ben was telling me about a friend that we have who came up with an idea for a show that I thought was hilarious called Strong Opinions.
Okay. Is it just the way you deliver them, or they're actually strong opinions?
Both. I think we've got a new host for Strong Opinions with J.R. Jackson. Yeah. Anyways, all right, let's take a quick break here. And we'll come back. We've got some more stories for you guys. All right, be right back, as my daughter says. Young Turks. Tom's walking with a nice compliment. He says, Cenk, best pun of the year, Obama taking the money and not giving us much change.
Okay. So many puns.
All right. Members of the day are Michael Wellborn, who's member number 3044, and Rajveer Barar, who is member number 3449. Now, if you want to become a member, go to tytnetwork.com/subscribe, okay? And you'll get to see all the postgames. On today's postgame, we're going to talk to Becca about her life. Okay.
I know. You're freaking out. You're just titillated.
Well, maybe you will be. It depends. Watch the postgame. So we're going to talk about where she grew up and how,
yeah,
what the whole thing was.
My origin story. It's,
yes. And she doesn't know it yet, but I can often be inappropriate. Anyways. Okay,
what?
That's for the postgame. That's for the members. TYTNetwork.com/subscribe. All right. Let's do some more stories, Becca.
Okay. So, when LL Cool J rapped, Mama Said Knock You Out, he did not mean this. So, a 34-year-old angry mother assaulted a middle school teacher, and her 14-year-old niece joined in. So, Anika McKenzie is charged with second-degree assault and strangulation, and her 14-year-old niece is facing second-degree assault charges as a juvenile, and this happened in New York in Hempstead, Long Island. So apparently this mother was enraged because the teacher, Catherine Engelhart, had apparently put her hands on her 12-year-old daughter. So she came into the school and assaulted her, attacked her, and her niece joined in, and then some other students allegedly also joined in. I mean, this kind of violence in schools happening between teachers and parents is truly disturbing. And this woman was unconscious, that she was actually choked her out until she was unconscious.
That's crazy.
Right, and it's kind of unbelievable that this is actually the state of our schools and that this sort of interaction is even possible.
Yeah, okay, so she says, the mom who knocked out the teacher, well, like, you know, she put her hands on my daughter. We don't know if that's true. Okay?
Right.
That's the word of the person who just choked the other person till they passed
out.
Yeah,
your credibility is slightly shot.
Yeah, it's got a little issues with credibility. But, like, so is the proper answer to go and put your hands on her, right? And there's no way that, I don't know what the teacher did. Again, just credibility issues. I'd be surprised if the teacher did anything. Okay?
Yeah, and this teacher has been here for 22 years.
Right. Whatever she did, it wasn't this, what you guys did, right? Mm-hmm. And the most disturbing part of the story is, so that they choke her out, she passed out. I don't know if they were scared. I'd be scared. Like, if I was in a fight with someone and they started and it was horrible and they're bad guys. But even so, if someone passes out, I'd be like, oh my God, did I kill him? What happened, right?
Right.
Meanwhile, other students are jumping in, kicking and punching. Jesus Christ, man, this is what some of our schools have turned into. And then we put teachers in jail if they cheat on exams, you know, which happened in Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is a situation that teachers find themselves in sometimes, right?
Well,
I know there's an extreme case, but I mean, these are tough circumstances to do teaching in. If anything, we've got to help the teachers in every way we can.
They should not feel unsafe in a work environment much. I mean, at a school especially. I mean, that is absolutely, it's unacceptable.
Yeah.
And the fact that it's happening, you know, in a school where, the fact that it was middle schoolers beating up a teacher, when a like there's a mother involved.
Look, I don't know, I grew up in a different environment. Like, the idea of my parents attacking a teacher is so unthinkable that,
yeah.
I mean, if I said it to my dad, a teacher hit me, I'm positive he would ask, what'd you do to deserve it, right? Now, teachers shouldn't be hitting students. That's crazy, right? And again, this is a situation we don't know that it happened at all, right? But, I mean, my dad's from the old school. The teacher's always right, right?
Mm-hmm.
And also, this is, I think, it's an interesting story because it's also symbolic of the new way of viewing teachers, which is my kid's always right. Your kid's 14. I mean, which 14-year-old's always right? You know, that, I mean, I honestly, maybe I'm from the old school, right? But I would be very skeptical of what my teenager is telling me that a teacher did, right? I mean, 14-year-olds are not the most credible people in the world.
Yeah.
Obviously, it depends on person by person and circumstance by circumstance.
Yeah, but you're basically talking to a hormone. You know,
yeah.
I mean, to put a really fine point on it, and I think for something like this, again, your daughter comes to you and says, the teacher touched her. That is a discussion you can have with a teacher. You don't get to choke her during that.
Obviously, right? I mean,
that's that.
It's just discouraging, this state of affairs these days in America, man. We got to protect our teachers. This is outrageous. And don't always assume your kid is right, okay? Sometimes your kid's the prick. You just remember that.
Yeah, and probably like 90% of the time.
Probably 90% of the time.
Just truth bomb right there. And I know this because I was like a prick kid. Like, this happens, but this kind of stuff is absolutely unacceptable, and, you know.
Yeah, once a teacher made me write out, like, I will not speak out in class like 100 times.
I could see that you probably mouthed off a little bit.
Yeah. Shocking. It turns out I spoke out of class, right? And I complained about it to my dad, whereupon he gave me one of the few beatings of my life. Like, he only spanked me 3 times, but one of the times was because I defied a teacher. And he's like, no, you don't get to complain about that. You shut your mouth, you don't disturb anybody else, and you learn. That's your job. Okay?
He really wanted to instill a sense of, like, there is a hierarchy or authority that you need to respect at a certain age.
Yeah, I feel like if I said to my dad, my teacher put her hands on me, he'd have been like, I'm next.
Right. He's like, and now this is happening.
Right. Okay. Anyway. All right. Next. Here comes Action Jackson.
Let's just keep it real. There's not a 100% chance that the teacher did nothing wrong. Let's just keep it real. That happens.
All right.
There's very bad teachers. There's teachers that actually assault kids. And, you know, I hear stories, and, you know, the people in the South where corporal punishment and, like, paddling and spanking is still considered a thing you can do to kids. Hell no, no, you're not touching my kid. Yeah, if my kid's acting up, you send him my way, you tell me what's going on. You don't take care of it there. So, again, I'm not assuming that teacher looked like she was a pretty small person. I thought it was a kid at first. I mean, just as far for a broad brush, I still want to assume that she did nothing wrong. That's all. You don't get to touch the kids. You don't. Sorry. No. I'm looking for you, too. My kid tells me that the teacher did something to him. I'm looking for you. I'm not looking for you I'm coming to kick your ass.
You're coming to have a conversation.
Yeah, we got to come talk. And they shouldn't have come to this point. But I don't know how that conversation went. But in general, and if I know I've raised an asshole kid who likes to lie and start shit, then yeah, I see where you're coming from. But if I know my kid's a good kid, and then this happens, I can't disbelieve the teacher over my kid.
So we do need more information on this story, but just based on the images and little we do know, yeah,
right.
I'm going to vote for the teacher on this one.
Yeah. Okay. And by the way, you know, we keep showing the two pictures. One's the teacher passed out. The other one is a mugshot of the mom. I just want to be clear on that. Okay, not the teacher. You can see who the teacher is on the ground. Okay. All right, let's move forward.
All right, so this next story is all quacked up. A back quack was offering spiritual and sexual healing in small town Iowa. So the residents of Lamoni, Iowa, found out that Charles Manuel had agreed to surrender his state license after being accused of accepting sex as a payment for his services and for performing, wait for this, exorcisms on his patients. I see you're looking at the logo, and I looked at the Lamoni Chiropractic Center logo, and I thought, you know what? These people should have known what they were in for, because just based on that alone, I'm actually not surprised that Charles Manuel was performing sexual acts.
Yeah, I mean, the logo's a sexual
act. Like, it's just, but it would be the fact. Like, so, basically, he was bartering there, you know, he would perform some sort of sexual acts with the patients if for his services, like, that was part of it. And then the exorcism thing, I wish I had more information on that.
Yeah, no, look, so I think I'm going to defend him a little bit. I know that's a little weird, okay? We're going to drop it in a second, because I think we've got some controversy here. But, look, I feel like the exorcism, if you think you're possessed by demons and he wants to help you out, you're both nuts. Have at it, Hoss. It's a free country. Right?
Okay. Yeah.
Right? And, like, if he says, okay, all you want me to fix your back, I'm going to need to have sex with you first, and you agree, I mean, it's a barter. You know, you're mm-hmm. trading services. That's not the direction I'd go, but I think you're going to do that. I think I got your back. Okay.
Oh, no. I mean, I this story is obviously just sort of shocking, and the thing is, too, this town is so idyllic. Like, the video I saw of it was just, like, American flags waving and, like, picket fences, and some of the local reactions, you know, people were like, that's ridiculous. I mean, an exorcism, obviously, some of these people were like, that's only in Stephen King novels, can possibly be happening across the street.
But it happens all the time. I mean, that's, you know, religious people, they believe in getting possessed by demons, and when people do exorcism, they're like, oh, that's weird. No, I mean, that's your religion. I mean,
yeah.
I don't believe it. You tell me you believe it. I don't. That's a different thing.
How does a chiropractor get into that, though? How do you put? His resume is fascinating.
How do you get in and out of this situation? In and out of this situation. I don't know.
I don't know how he did it. I'm just. But like, I guess if you're consensual adults, just trying to exorcise some demons, which however you do that.
Yeah, it happens. Look, okay, let's open it up. Let's drop it. Do a Supreme Court up. Okay, I'm assuming in this story that everything is consensual. I don't see anything in the story that says it's not consensual. If it's not consensual, it's over, it's easy, there's no Supreme Court, guilty, and you should go to jail. Like, that's easy, right? But no one's complaining that it's non-consensual. So, assuming that it's consensual, I vote not guilty. I don't see... I mean, they should take his license away. License away to do what? To fix your back? I mean, in exchange for sex? No, not guilty. What do you think?
Oh, this is a tough one because it's kooky. It's super kooky. But I'm like, is he within his rights? Like you said, if it's consensual and this is just an agreement between two, you know, adults who are like, okay, I would like for you to check out this vertebrae and also, like, stick it in my butt.
A little back action, a little
like,
butt action.
Whatever, you know, like right. That. I mean, if that is that, if that's the conversation, far be it from me to stop anyone from, you know, pursuing those kinds of economic transactions.
We're for freedom. Let's go to the other justice, Justice Jackson. What say you?
No, I gotta go guilty on the doctor here. I mean, there's just because. I mean, if it's a basic normal case, yeah, people want to do what they want to do. But I feel like we could get into some messy areas here where, you know, you have people could be desperate. They have their back issues. And then so he may talk to them and other things that they normally didn't want to be involved with. Maybe they're on something. It's just it could get where he has a lot of control over other people. And it could get that bad. Again, if we're talking basic, yeah, people do what they want. But it just seems like the realm of what you don't want it to be. And also, say I'm going to that doctor's office second. I don't know what's on that bed and what's on the...
Oh.
I mean, you can't do that stuff in a professional setting.
Okay, yeah. Agree to disagree.
You're going to go in that office after he's been...
Well, JR, you might disagree if you need an exorcist, you know, and also your back is tight.
Okay. Well, no, JR makes great points. Look, it's, you know, he has holds a certain degree of power over that person. It's a different relationship than you would if you're just meeting at a bar, right? And I that's a great point. I think one part of it is that I don't really believe the chiropractor is in that much position of power. It's like, it depends. Like, if you're a cop, you can't do that. Be like, oh, I will rescue you from this smuggler as long as you agree to have sex with me. Of course you can't do that, right? If you're a judge, you can't do that, right? And I feel like if you're a regular doctor and somebody walks in and they're bleeding, you can be like, okay, look, I can help you with you with that as long as you agree to do X, right? No, of course you can't do that. But with a chiropractor and an exorcist,
right,
I feel like you got a lot of choices. There's a lot of different directions you can go with that. And if you choose to get help from this guy, well, you kind of had it coming. And I guess
so did he. I just wonder how all of this came to light, you know, how the board discovered that he was performing exorcisms and also, you know, cracking people's backs, and how, you know, whether, because that maybe belies the fact that there was some things happening that were not okay between the patient and the doctor that, you know, somebody decided to tell the authorities.
You're right. Well, that's a fair point. All right. Finally, Justice Godoy.
JR made the great point of, like, them holding so much power over you, and then if you go there for other...
And also, Jake, I want to make sure that this doesn't go unnoticed. You do not deserve the sad trombone for the "you had it coming," and so did he. It got muffled in the conversation. I enjoyed that one.
All right, thank you. I appreciate that.
he wanted you to know.
All right, thank you. I appreciate that final story. Let's do it.
All right, this one's pretty fun. Ex-Popo hit the pipe. So Cut.com, who is responsible for the viral video of grannies smoking ganja, have a new video to celebrate 420, and they took former police officers and got them just ripping the bong, doing all sorts of fun stuff. They got the munchies. They did some sobriety tests. Actually, I have a clip of this video that we should share now.
There you go.
Starting at 93, count backwards by 7. 93, 86, 79, 72. Lift your right foot up.
Okay.
Hold it for 20 seconds. Count to 10.
Okay. How about 5?
I think he's actually better.
Actually better than what? Better than before.
I feel a little floaty. It's not unpleasant, but it's shadowed by the faint discomfort of not being fully whatever.
That's kind of what police officers do. They're very staunch. They're very in control all the time. This doesn't necessarily allow you to do that.
Okay.
Pretty hilarious.
Got
yeah.
it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I love these. You know, they're cops, so he can't get out of that mentality too much, where he's like, this is not unpleasant.
I know.
It's okay, dude. Just let it go. Just relax for a second. Enjoy the buzz you got going on.
Yes, and it was legal because this happened in Washington State, where the recreational use of marijuana is allowed.
Yeah.
So.
And I like how they did like cop tricks to one another.
Right? Yeah, the sobriety test.
Dude, the sobriety test of 96 minus
That's
7.
Hard. I'm
like,
sorry.
What? I'm like, wait, now hold
like,
on.
Give me an abacus. Like, can't do it.
The first couple were challenging, whether you're sober or not sober. So, and then, of course, that's when the cops are like, oh, wait a minute. I don't know if you're, like, well, give me a minute here. I'm doing the math, okay?
Like, easy. Right. There's another part of the video where they talk about legalizing marijuana, and they kind of give their opinions. And the guy with the stash, the epic stash, he's my favorite character in this. He said that he actually thinks that this is the last bit of prohibition. Like, he thinks it should be legalized. He's like, it's dumb. The amount of arrests that he made of people that he was like, did not deserve to be in jail, that kind of thing. And they also asked these ex-cops if they felt like marijuana was a gateway drug. Mm-hmm. And the same guy with the stash was like, oh yeah, because milk is obviously where all heroin addicts started, so let's point the finger there. Like, making the point that, you know, he was just like, he's an open-minded guy. And so maybe doesn't represent the entire, like, Like, this is a specific slice of the police force.
Yeah, obviously they did this video for a reason, and it's obviously, I don't think they were going to put in cops who were going to be like, this is dangerous and horrible, I can't believe I smoked a ganja.
Right.
But yeah, it's hard not to like these guys. So it's a nice little cue, hey, it's a bunch of ex-cops. Turns out it's not that bad. Maybe you should stop arresting people for it.
And there was some real sex talk in there, too. They kind of...
Oh, really?
Yeah, at the beginning, he was talking about, again, Stash Guy, my fave, was talking about how his first time smoking weed was with an agreeable woman on a waterbed, listening to Rhapsody in Blue. And I was like, agreeable women on waterbeds.
That sounds pretty good.
Yeah. But it's fun. It's a really, it's like a 6-minute video, so it takes a little bit of your time, but I would say worth it on 420.
Ah, the good old days when I was single and met agreeable women.
and apparently had a waterbed, because not allowed anymore.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. I think there's an age limit.
Okay, yeah, well, that might be true, yes. I was on a waterbed at 18. It was fun. It was good.
That was a good time.
It was, and it was with an agreeable woman.
Oh, I'm so glad to have that mental image.
Sorry about that. All right. We're done for the show. If you're a member, stick around. Becca's going to tell us all about her past.
Waterbed.
I don't know if there are waterbeds involved, but we're going to find out. Bye. Bye-bye.